concert on Saturday night in Wisconsin, and we flew back on Sunday. And another friend of ours, Sarah Fisterer, who's also in Phantom, we were just sitting in the by the gate, yapping away, and I went over to
and
a magazine.
And we missed it.
Yeah, we missed it. We missed the bloody plane. Like three old women, me included. All right. So, glad you're here. As Bonnie said, third time's a charm, we hope. We thought we'd start off with a little song from my first Broadway show called Les Miserables. This song is set in front of the barricades in Paris. Jean Valjean is praying, it's a prayer, and he's praying to God that spare young Marius' life. This is called Bring Him Home. Song. I remember when I first did the show, I met a gentleman who's here actually tonight. Steve, where are you?
Yeah.
Where? Oh, there you are. Okay. So Steve and I were both working on Les Mis. He was one of the lead carpenters on the show, and I wasn't with the show very long because I went right from Les Mis into Phantom, and then he actually turned out to be the lead carpenter on that particular tour of Phantom. And I was out on the road for a few, I guess about 9 months, and then I came into the Broadway company. And didn't see him again. And then, let's see, aging myself now, I think around nearly 20 years later, I was taking an acting class in New York, and my acting teacher paired me up with this young lady. And he said, she was also in Phantom, so it was great. So it turns out that our next performer is actually married to Steve. So, Miss Eagleton, where are you?
Thank you so much. Yes, Phantom is a very extended family. There are so many of us, and we love each other, and our wonderful pianist, who's also a conductor, Sue, is also married to a former Phantom. So we all get along really well, especially when we're not touring on the road together. This is also from Les Miserables.
good thing she's pretty, because she can't sing. Alrighty, my mother's here tonight. Isn't that lovely? And, we're both from Dublin. And, so this next song that Sue and I would like to do for you, one of my favorite all-time songs, based on a poem by Patrick Kavanagh, and it was set to an ancient air called Fáilean Bath, which means the dawning of the day in Irish. I think we have another, someone else said they were from Dublin. Is there someone else from Dublin here? Other than my mother? Where? Not you, you terror. What county are you from, young fella?
Limerick.
Yeah, thought so. Limerick, or as we would say in Ireland, Stab City. Ouch, it's a rough crowd. No, someone said there was a woman from Dublin here. Where are you? Where are you? Here goes the private conversations. Where are you from in Dublin?
Blaston.
Blah! Oh, nice! Nice! My grandfather's in Blaston, so is my granny. But they're about 6 feet under normal surface of Blaston. Sorry? Thanks. Anyway, this is for the two Dublin women here tonight, and my mother in particular. This is called Raglan Road.
ghost's light, I do see her walking down. Away from me so hurriedly, my reason must allow that I had would not, as I should, a creature made of clay. When the angels the clay illumines, his wings at the dawn
It's lovely to see you.
It's lovely to see you, but it's my turn now.
Oh.
Get off the bloody stage, will you?
Just practicing the walk.
Oh, fair. How's that going for you? Do you want to do it again? Do you want to see her do it again? She doesn't need the encouragement from you. Is this woman not... Look at this woman. Now, I have a little story to tell you. Sue and I... Well, let me back up a little further. When Sue and I met, I thought to myself, oh my God, she looks like Linda Carter. Wonder Woman. Right, do you see it? See? She goes, No. But, so I'm always going, Wonder Woman! And looking for the bracelets, you know.
You keep saying you're going to get me some bracelets.
I'm going to get you some bracelets. I think Shireen Banff is here tonight. I'll get you some bracelets. Is Shireen here? No Shireen. All right. You'll have to wait another day for your bracelets. Anyway, so we were up in Boston, and I said, she looks like Linda Carter. And they all like, oh, yes. And then she said,
without the tits.
So, I'm recounting this story on Saturday night in Wisconsin. And,
this is a true story.
This is very true. You know, at Wisconsin, people are very, very polite. And if you say, gosh, there's a little tension in the room. You know, not like out here. And, but she said it anyway, and the place erupted. So, do you want to tell them what happened after?
Well, afterwards, we're out in the lobby, right? And this older woman comes up to me and she said, you know what, you really do look like Linda Carter. And I'm going, yeah, you know, da 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 da. And she said, and you're right, you don't have the tits.
But it was well intended, right?
It was well intended. She was very helpful. And she said, there are things you can do about that. You can even take some toilet paper and put it in your bra. True story, that happened.
Absolutely
and
true.
And she was trying to be helpful.
Yeah.
I mean, it was hysterical.
Yeah. Anyway.
She couldn't understand why I was laughing. She was trying to help me.
All right, should we leave the stage to yourself, young lady? All right.
This is a little medley from a show called Jesus Christ Superstar. Feel free to sing along.
Thank you.
So, Miss Anderson?
Yes, darling.
What's going on with that pedal?
Oh, I just kept pushing back, so I put my foot on it.
Nick?
Nick's abducted.
Nick?
I'll get it in the mission.
He's got it ready. Look at this guy. This is Nick. Nick and Hess have been taking care of us all day. Thank you so much.
Is Peter Link out there somewhere?
Yes.
Peter? Great. I wanted to thank Peter because we had a bit of a dilemma. We wanted to do a concert, but we didn't have a piano. So we pursued all avenues at all costs and, you know, acoustic and digital, and so he came up with the idea to contact the Guitar Center, and just as a little thank you to the Guitar Center in Totowa, they even gave us a little bit of a discount because they knew it was for a benefit. So thank you for the idea, Peter. Thank you, Guitar Center. Our next song is from the musical The Secret Garden. It's based on the classic British novel, and The music was written by Lucy Simon, who is Carly Simon's older sister. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with Carly Simon. And she also has written the new musical, the music for the new musical, Dr. Zhivago, which is in previews on Broadway and opens later this month. In this story, Archibald Craven is a hunchback, and he lost his wife, Lily, 10 years ago, shortly after the birth of their only child. And she had fallen from a branch of a tree in her garden. And so as a result of that, he has locked the garden and he has sequestered their son for fear that he may also be fragile because of a spinal deformity. So in How Could I Ever Know, Archie hears Lily's voice.
How could I know I would have to leave you? How could I know I would hurt you so? You, the one I was born to love, oh, how our love. Come, go with me, safe I will keep you.
Where you would lead me, there I would.
There I would, there we would.
There we would go.
The Irish Tenors, which I'm sure you've all heard of, the Irish Tenors. And, my friend Carl Scully is up there in the balcony. He's the one from Limerick. Right, so he often does this in concert, and so Carl, this is for you. This is about a farmer, and I always place him in the southwest of Ireland, which is where my father's family is from, and it's a much more fun accent. It's about a farmer who has two daughters, and he wants to see them happily married, or as I like to say, he wants them out of the bloody house. And one of them is charming, she's beautiful, the fellas are banging down the doors to get to this young lady. And the other one is a little plain. So the farmer comes up with the idea of offering a young cow, a heifer, with the plainer daughter in the hopes that some young man will find this very enticing and offered to marry her. This is called McBreen's Heifer.
McBreen had two daughters, and each one in turn was offered and managed to James E. O'Byrne. Now Kitty was pretty, but James, she was plain. So to make up the differ, McBreen would explain. He'd give the best every man in the land as a sort of a bonus with chain, understand. Now Kitty could charm a bird off a bush, and that left her man in a horrid non-blush. Now there's no denying Kitty was remarkably pretty, though I can say the same for Jane. Still there's not the differ in the price of a heifer between the pretty and the plain. Entirely bothered was James E. O'Byrne. He thought that he'd give the schoolmaster a turn. Says he,
to wed Kitty is very good fun. Still a heifer's a heifer when all's said and done. A girl, she might lose her good looks anyhow. And a heifer might grow to an elegant cow. But still there's no price for the stock, do you mind? And Jane has a face that the devil designed.
I didn't write.
No. There's no denying Kitty was remarkably pretty, though I can't say the same for Jane. Still there's not the differ in the price of a heifer between the pretty and the plain. The schoolmaster said with a good deal of sense,
we'll reduce the two girls to shillings and pence. At the price of the heifer, then Jane I'll be bound, we'll come out of the top by a couple of pound. But still I'm forgetting that down in Glencore the stock is just going for nothing at all.
So Jim could he wait till the end of the year,
till girls might be cheaper,
our stock might be dear. Ah, but when it came for Kitty, she was married to McBitty, and McGee had appropriated Jane. So whether there's a dipper in the price of a heifer is a thing that he never could explain. All right, gentlemen.
It's hard to imagine that Oklahoma was the first collaboration between Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein III. When it came time to figure out how they were going to follow such a critical success and popular success, the Theater Guild of New York City proposed that they use darker source material in Ferenc Molnár's Lilium, which they had also produced. Molnár had declined all previous requests, but he did give his permission to Rodgers and Hammerstein, who changed the name to Carousel, moved the setting from Budapest to the east coast of Maine, added a little comic relief, and changed the ending to one of hope. In If I Loved You, mill worker Julie Jordan and Carousel barker Billy Bigelow.
I always feel compelled to bark when you say that.
Put at risk everything in their lives for what they're feeling in this moment. I don't know how I know. Just the same, I know how I. How would it be if I loved you? When I worked in the mill, weaving at the loom, I gaze absent-minded at the roof. And half the time the shuttle could tangle in the threads of the warp mixed with the woof. If I loved you.
But you don't.
No, I don't. But somehow I can see just exactly how I'd be. If I loved you.
Time and again, I would try to say. come in an easy way. Round in circles I'm running to tell you, not afraid and shy. I let my golden chances pass me by.
So you give me
did his revival at Lincoln Center there in the 90s. My wife was in the show. We'd actually met through Phantom. It's so funny. I mean, as Gwen was saying, such a small world. She was the dance captain on Phantom, and it was her job to try and teach me the choreography. And they actually brought me in a week early for rehearsals. And after about 3 or 4 days, they said, maybe we should adjust the choreography. But she couldn't straighten out my dancing, but she's been trying to straighten me out since then at home. But this song talks about Billy has just found out that Julie is expecting, and he's sure it's going to be a boy, and we get to hear all of his inner thoughts. It's the first time we really get to see Billy's heart in the show, because most of the time he thinks with his fists. This is called the soliloquy.
I wonder what he'll think of me. I guess he'll call me the old man. I guess he'll think I can lick every other fella's father. Well, I can. I bet that he'll turn out to be the smitten image of his dad, but he'll have more common sense than his pudding-headed father ever had. I'd teach him to wrestle and dive through a wave when we go in the mornings for our swim. His mother can teach him the way to behave, but she won't make a sissy out of him. Not him, not my boy, not firm on the ground, and you won't see nobody dare to try to boss him or toss him around.
And I don't give a damn what he does, as long as he does what he likes. He can sit in his tail or work in a rail with a hammer and spikes. He can ferry a boat in a river or peddle a pack in his back. He can haul a scow along the canal, run a cow around a corral, or maybe bark for a carousel. Of course, it takes talent to do that well. He might be champion of heavyweights, or a fella that sells you glue, or president of the United States. That'd be all right, too. His mother would like that, but he wouldn't be president unless he wanted it. Not Bill,
my boy Bill, he'll be tall and as tough as a tree. Bill, Bill. tree he'll grow with his head held high and his feet planted firm on the ground. And you won't see nobody dare to try to boss him or toss him around. No, black bottom, flabby face, pot belly, baggy eyed bastard will boss him around. And a dandy will marry his boss's daughter, a skinny lipped virgin with blood like water. Call it a kiss and look in his eyes through a lorgnette. Say, why am I taking on like this? My kid ain't even been born yet. I can see him when he's 17 or so and starting to grow with a girl. I can give him lots of pointers, very sound, on the way to get around any girl. I can tell him. Wait a minute. What the hell? What if he is a girl? Bill. Oh, Bill. What do I do with it? What could I do for a bum with no money? You can have fun with a son, but you gotta be a father to a girl. She mightn't be so bad at that. A kid with ribbons in her hair, a kind of neat and petite little tin type of a mother. What a pair! As peaches and cream is she. My little girl is half again as bright as girls are meant to be. Dozens of boys pursue her, many a lively lad does what he can to woo her from her faithful dad. Has a few pink and white young fellas of two or three, but my little girl gets hungry every night, and she comes home to me. I gotta get ready before she comes. I gotta make certain that she will be dragged up and slaughtered to the blood of bums like me. She's gonna be sheltered and fed and dressed in the best that money can buy. I never knew about it in money, but I'll try, my God, I'll try. I'll go out and make it, or steal it, or take it, or
charm. That was kind of my idea. I said, well, we have to call it Three's the Charm. How many of you out there were all set for our first concert, which was in October? Raise your hands. Okay. And how about the second concert, which got canceled because of the blizzard, state of emergency in New Jersey? Cool. So how many of you, would have been to all three events? Like, if we'd done all three, would have been there? That's so cool.
Bonnie would have been.
So, and how many of you who could only come tonight, so if we hadn't done it tonight, you would have missed this event? Okay. Anyway, we're so glad to see you all here
tonight. Hang on.
Yes, what?
Are you giving them a prize, you know?
I just thought it was fun to acknowledge the people who, you know, keep getting the little email saying, well, it's moved.
Well, I think you better figure out a prize for them later.
But I also wanted to just take a moment to explain how I know about Shakespeare Theater of New Jersey. And we're so grateful for this opportunity, and we're grateful for your support for this institution and the training program for the young artists. It was first on my radar from the acting studio that where Kieran and I met. There was a fellow, a young guy, good, very good actor, who talked about working out here. So that first put it on my radar. And then I taught, I was an adjunct professor at the University of Wisconsin in Stevens Point. You could probably hear the Chicago, kind of the Midwestern thing come out every now and then. She, Susan Maris, started doing plays out here, and I came out and saw her in The Grapes of Wrath. How many people saw The Grapes of Wrath out here? Well, she was just heartbreaking. I mean, I just saw her, and it's fun to see a student become a woman actress. She's done a lot of shows out here, so that's really what first got me out here. And then I said to Kieran, there's this great theater in New Jersey you've got to come see. So we've been seeing things out here, and we just appreciate the caliber of work and the artists that are out here and Bonnie's vision. And so we're so happy that we're all united here tonight for this purpose. So thank you. Thank you. So this next song, it's one of those that translated from musical theater into popular music. It was written by George and Ira Gershwin, and it was written for the musical O.K. That's O-H comma K-A-Y, exclamation point, not OK, like everything's good. It's for O.K. in 1926. Thank you.
just her crew. She lets me sing a few songs, though.
Alrighty, we'd like to finish up this half with one more tune here from a show that was done here a few years ago, I believe for the 50th anniversary of the theater, when they did Man of La Mancha. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Am I right? Yeah. Alrighty, and this is an old favorite. Hope I remember the bloody words. Yeah. Down. Did you not get my text? Look at this. A private conversations during a bloody concert. Anyway. What?
We got our phones off.
Oh, you're good theater goers. They didn't have their phones on. That's right. Right. This, as I said to you earlier, my mom is here. And,
Where?
Sorry? She's over there. Bring her up. Bring her up. Do you want to see me killed? Bring her up. She'd hand me my head. We were both from Dublin, and we moved around a lot, part of my childhood. In fact, I remember, I just heard a phone. It's not mine! We moved around a lot. I remember, I figured out when I was around 12, between October, when I turned 12, and the following August, we moved from Dublin to Clare, to Limerick, to just north of Chicago, to New Jersey, to down near Princeton, Lawrenceville, to back to Dublin. And but there was a time we were in Chicago, and it was a very hard time for my mother. And God love her, she put up with a lot. First of all, she had to deal with me, and but my father actually started to see another woman, Ooh, the room just got really tight, didn't it? Yeah. And, you know, the Irish, we don't talk about much. You know, we sort of pretend it's not going on. And, but it got a little awkward when he started bringing her home. And, well, this song tells you, actually, it'll give you her name. So,
there's a lady living somewhere. Where it is, I do not know. But I long to write and tell her that I love her so. Now I may consider mayhem, and I might destroy myself. If I ever found her missing from my grocer's shelf. Your brioche just fractures me. Give me a taste of your cherry Danish. My mother bakes well, aunt, you can't compare her not with Sara Lee. Sara Lee. There's no H, just Sara Lee. When I'm nibbling her apple spice from the kitchen of the one I love, wonderful Sara Lee. And it thrills me right to my soul when I'm chewing her finger roll. You hear me holler, for goodness sake, there's never been a better banana cake. Cousin Milton works at the Hilton. He caters banquets and at each affair he swears by Sara Lee. I know you know what I mean. Sara Lee, ain't her brownies obscene? Drop that H, just Sara Lee, and that's okay by me. I love your cheesecake, white as pearl. And did I mention that chocolate swirl from the kitchen of the one I love? Wonderful Sara, beautiful Sara, S-A-R-A-L-E-E, Sara Lee.
That's cake. So the first time I did that and my parents were in the audience, my father's like, what the hell is he talking about? What the hell is he going on about? But the truth is that when we lived in just north of Chicago, he actually worked in the Sara Lee factory. And he started bringing that cake home, boy. And my mother was not very happy. All right. I should go away, shouldn't I? Oh, I'm here to carry, I'm here to carry the stool again.
Of all the songs, the wonderful songs that Stephen Sondheim has contributed to musical theater, one has been recorded over 900 times. It may represent one of the last vestiges of the days of Cole Porter, Irving Berlin, the Gershwin Brothers, Rodgers and Hart, where musical theater was a viable source for popular music, as opposed to now when we have jukebox musicals, which is let's take a bunch of popular songs and try to create a story around them and throw them into a show. So this song that's coming up is, it is Sendin' the Clowns. I guess you probably figured out what that was. And it was written specifically for Glynis Johns, who was playing the role of Desiree Armfelt in the, she was the original Desiree Armfelt, and it was in its pre-Broadway run. And Hal Prince noticed that she needed a number in the second act. So Stephen Sondheim wrote the song in 2 days. And he said this is the way he really likes to write. He prefers to write for the actress, in the character, in the moment, just even, you know, seeing the production at work. So I guess he works his best that way. He prefers it. And he says of all the wonderful recordings that follow, the voice that's always in his head is that of the first actor that embodied that character for him that he wrote the music for. The song found its popular audience in two very different type of artists. The first was Frank Sinatra, was the first one. He was hot on the heels of the show. He pretty much got that single out right after the show. And then 2 years later, Judy Collins released it in London. So if you're not familiar with the circumstances, Desiree, I guess we would consider her a regional theater actress. So she's committed her life to playing great roles all over the country. And on one of her stops, she meets a handsome lawyer, Frederick Eggermann, and they have an affair, and he loves her, and it actually, unbeknownst to him, produces a child, a daughter, that Desiree never told him about, but she was intent on forging her career. So 13 years later, Frederick brings his young, very young, still virgin bride after 11 months to see Desiree in one of her performances, and Desiree sees him in the audience, they lock eyes, and they end up having a tryst. And when that happens, she realizes that he was the one, and at this point, she's ready to settle down and how wonderful it would be for Frederica to know her father. And so, and she sees he's with this crazed young girl who is actually in love with his son. And they run away together. So it all works out lovely in the end. But in this moment, she proposes to him, you know, maybe she could rescue him. Could they turn back the clock? And to that, he says that he would rather continue trying to renew his unrenewable youth, continue in that attempt. So stay with his young bride, his young virgin bride. And so Desiree responds this way to him. Isn't it rich?
And where are the clubs? There ought to be clouds. Well, maybe next year.
You feel sorry for me? Working with these two women? It's awful. This next piece that we'd like to do for you is based on an ancient air from the north of Ireland. I often have a debate with my friend Gabriel Donoghue, who played with the Chieftains for a number of years. He says this is a French song, and I said it's not a French song, it's an Irish song. He said it is a French song, it's the Derriere. Ah. Rough crowd. And it was set to words in 1912 by an English attorney named Fred Weatherly. This is called Danny Boy.
Until you're gone.
I was very blessed on Saturday morning to get to sing that at a wonderful gentleman's memorial service. And I think his daughter, Marguerite, is here. Marguerite, where are you? Are you here? Oh, no. Okay, she said she was going to try and come tonight. Anyway, it was a great privilege. It was Tom Waits, the composer, guitar singer, his father-in-law, and they asked me if I'd come by and sing that for them. So, I think we'll stay not with an Irish song, but maybe with another Irish singer. Carl Scully, come down here. Wow. Sorry? What?
Oh, the
bridge over the River Kwai. On my children's lives, he had no idea. You're a disgrace to the country. Are you appalled that he's in jeans?
No.
Right, shut up and sing a song.
I pull my jeans too, so I can't turn my back to the audience. This one right here. Oh, watch. Wow, okay. Yeah. Oh, do you have one? All right, yeah. Talk to them, will you? Oh my goodness, my brain is not in the right place for this at all. Why, because of the hole? Thank you.
You're welcome.
Well, thankfully, I don't know about you, but this winter has been quite long. And, as Kieran has reminded me, there are many happy pastimes that, of course, are only available to us in spring and summer, and I would love to share one of these pastimes with you this evening, if you don't mind. So, after you, my dear. Hi, baby. Spring is here. Spring is here. Life is Skittles and life is beer. I think the loveliest time of the year is the spring. I do. Don't you? Of course you do. But there's one thing that makes spring complete for me, that makes every Sunday a treat for me. All the world seems in tune on a spring afternoon as we're poisoning pigeons in the park. On Sunday you'll see my sweetheart and me as we poison the pigeons in the park. Ace, yes, coming, the birdies all try and hide, but they still go for peanuts that are coated with cyanide. The sun's shining bright, everything seems all right when you're poisoning pigeons in the park. We've gained notoriety and caused some anxiety in the Audubon Society with our games. They call it impiety and a lack of propriety and quite a variety of unpleasant names. But it's not against any religion to want to dispose of a pigeon. So if Sunday you're free, why don't you come with me and we'll poison the pigeons in the park. And maybe we'll do in a squirrel or two as we poison the pigeons in the park. We'll herd them all amid laughter and merriment. Except Fuzzy Fuvy, take on to experiment. My pulse will be quickening with each drop of strychnine we feed to a pigeon. It just takes a smidgen to poison a pigeon in the park.
Hurley. Missed the playout music, which is absolutely a brilliant idea. We were doing a concert about a year or so ago with the Allentown Concert Band, and Carl sang Poisoning Pigeons in the Park, and the band, just by happenstance, went into Feed the Birds from Mary Poppins. Tuppence a bag. Anyway, thanks, Carl. I swear he had no idea, and I walked in, I said to Sue a couple of days ago, do you have Poisoning Pigeons? And she said, yeah, and then when we got here today, I saw there was an umbrella on the other side. Like, it's from God. Anyway, I'm going to turn you over to Sue here for a little something.
Fabulous, Carl. Thank you so much. Okay, I'm going to bring us back to the first act with some more Les Mis music. So again, feel free to sing or dance.
Thank you. Sorry. Dance break.
This is why they changed the choreography when I went into the show. And speaking of that show and that role, we'd like to do something now from Phantom. This is set on the rooftops of Paris. The Phantom has frightened Christine, and Raoul is there to comfort her with All I Ask of You.
Forget these wide-eyed fears I mean. Nothing can harm you. My words will warm and calm you. Let me be your freedom. Let daylight dry your tears I mean. With you beside you, to guard you and to guide you.
Christine's would do.
Oh my gosh. Well,
upstage where the audience can't see. And I didn't even do that.
You didn't.
So shall I go on? I think it's me. It's me.
Oh, it's you.
It is me. This time it is me.
It is you. Yeah, I have a little story about that.
Great.
What we in the theater call just happened was going up. Of course, now Sue was on my right going, Cher! But I remember one night when I played Raoul for a couple of years and then I started playing the Phantom. And when you get into a long run like that, the worst thing you can do is start thinking. And at the end of the show, there's the portcullis, and Raoul jumps off of the travelator, the bridge, and makes his way to the portcullis, and there's this exchange back and forth between himself and myself. And his last line is, "Let me see her!" And I say, "Be my guest, sir." And then I go into, "Monsieur, I bid you welcome. Did you think that I would harm her? Why should I make her pay for the sins which are yours?" And I put the noose over his neck. So one night, the idiot decides to start thinking. And let me see her. "Be my guest, sir. Monsieur." And as soon as I got monsieur out of my mouth, I went, "I have no bloody idea what the third word is." None. So I thought, my background is rock and roll. I used to sing in a heavy metal band. And telling you the truth now. And I love R&B. And so I thought, what do I do? I have no idea what to say. I'll turn into James Brown. So I went, "Monsieur, I bid you yours!" I knew that bloody word, though. Anyway, it happens. It happens more as we get older. Anyway, they're all yours.
There's lots of wonderful stories about the Phantom days. We're gonna do three songs from Phantom, and the second one is "Wishing You Were Somehow Here Again," and there's a reference at the beginning of this song about Little Lottie. Have you ever wondered, who is Little Lottie? Did anyone wonder? Well, anyway, I'm gonna tell you a little bit. It's a character, actually, in a poem that Christine Daae's father used to read to her, and the story is actually about a young girl who finds a wounded bird and takes it in and nurses it back to health, and then when the spring comes and the bird is well, it wants to fly out of the cage, but she doesn't want to let it go. So she keeps it in the cage and the bird dies, and it's her first introduction to sorrow, and so that's about the poem. And so Christine Daae's father's a concert violinist, and he tells her the story, and so she knows who Little Lottie is. And then he also weaves in the story about the angel of music. And so Christine, in this setting, her father has died. She's feeling the loss of that and wants to go on with her life. So she's in the mausoleum where he's interred. And she's wondering if the phantom maybe is that angel of music that her father promised her.
bells and sculpted angels, cold and monumental. Seem for you the wrong companions. You were warm and gentle.
As to why I sing, other than I didn't want to finish my electrical engineering degree, was because of my mother. And she introduced me to the joy and the love of music. I'm sure she didn't appreciate a lot of the music that I ended up singing when I was singing AC/DC and Judas Priest, but she gave me a real love for music. And that sort of guided my life. And so, Mom, this one's. This one's for you.
Sensation, darkness stirs and wakes imagination. Silently the senses abandon their defenses. Unfurls its splendor, grasp it, sense it, tremulous and tender. Turn your face away from the garish light of day. Turn your thoughts away from cold, unfeeling light. And listen to the music of the night. Close your eyes and surrender to your darkest dreams. Let your thoughts of the life in you before. Close your eyes, let your spirit start to soar. left me. Music shall caress you. Hear it, feel it, secretly possess you. Open up your mind, let your fantasies unwind in this darkness which you know you cannot fight. The darkness of the music of the night. Let your mind start a journey through a strange new world. Leave all thoughts of the world you knew before. Let your soul take you where you long to be. Only then can you belong to me. Floating, falling, sweet intoxication. Touch me, trust me, savor each sensation. Let the dream begin, let a darker side give in to the power of the music that I write. The power of the music of
stuff without all that pizza on your face. So we've had an absolutely lovely time with you here tonight. Thank you so much for coming out and supporting this wonderful, wonderful theater, as Gwen was saying, and particularly the young people's education programs here, training programs. My 13-year-old has developed a bit of a passion for Shakespeare. And so I'm taking him to some coaching, and he's really loving it. So thank you for supporting that. Shakespeare, it never ceases to astonish me. The brilliance. I often think there's no way that man, that individual man, wrote all that. It just had to be sort of this nearly open gateway to God. The brilliance and the subtleties and the understanding of humanity and all the lessons that we can learn. And so to pass that along to young people is really fabulous. So thank you so much for supporting that. And Bonnie, thank you so much for building something extraordinary here, because I know when you first took over, the place was a bloody wreck. And in debt, and within a year she had it flush, and I don't know, I'm talking out of school here, but when she was called to take over, she said, "That's one of the worst regional theaters in the country," and which was true. It sort of didn't have a great reputation, and but she's turned it into. I believe it was the Wall Street Journal, right? Recently said one of the best regional theaters in the country, and that's just.
And that happens with your support.
It does indeed. So thank you, and thanks for making tonight possible for us to come in and have a bit of fun and share some time with you, Bonnie and Kristen, and everyone at the office who's helped put this together, and everyone out front.
Rick,
and
Rick, if he's here.
And Rick, yeah? Is Rick here?
Yeah. Oh, great.
No, all right. And one of the reasons that we first started coming here, beyond Gwen's knowledge of some of the actors working here, was my very good friends, Bruce and Nancy Tucker, who are sitting here in the second row. And I know Bruce is a great advocate of the theater here, and offers, he's an amazing financial advisor, so he's always here with some ideas. And so thank you. Thank you. But I'm afraid it's time to say goodbye. Thank you very much. We, thank you. We, We have a tradition in Ireland where we usually end an evening with a particular song that was actually made famous in Scotland. And before Auld Lang Syne, it was always the sort of the New Year's Eve song. So we'd like to do a couple of verses for that to say goodnight and hope you've had a lovely time and enjoy yourselves.
Send you safely on your way. And then I guess we're meeting some of you after this too.
Yeah, but we'll be out in the lobby though, right after the show as well. So this is called
The Parting Glass.
And if you know it, sing along. Carl Scully.
Oh, all the money that e'er I had, I spent it in good company. And of all the harm that e'er I've done, alas, it was to none but me. And all I've done for want of wit, to memory now I can't recall. So fill to me the parting glass. Good night, and joy be with you all.
Oh, for the comrades that here I have, they are sorry for my going away. And of all the sweethearts that e'er I had, they would wish me one more day to stay. But since it falls unto my lot that I should rise and you should not, I'll gently rise and softly call good night and joy.